Good morning, children. Welcome to another session of biology of class 12. And this video lesson is again with the same chapter, evolution. And we are dealing with the theories of evolution. We dealt with the two theories earlier, that is Lamarckism and Darwinism. And in this section, we'll mainly deal with the other two theories. That is the mutation theory, which was given by Hugo de Vries, and the modern theory or the synthetic theory of evolution. And this is part 5. So let us start. Children, the first it is the third theory on evolution. The previous two we already discussed. This is the mutation theory of evolution, and as you know, it was given by Hugo de Vries. Now, according to him, what was all about this theory? New species are not formed by continuous or gradual variations. Okay, means they are not by very slow. It is not a very slow process. Means when new species are formed, they are always produced by sudden appearance of variations, and which are heritable. And these variations were called by Hugo de Vries as the mutations. So what he was trying to tell is that what Darwin told in the previous theory, that the whenever new species are formed, they are produced by continuous and very slow variations. And Hugo de Vries told was that whenever mutation occurs or whenever a new species is formed, always it is by sudden appearance of variations and not very slow process. Means he told it is a discontinuous process. Actually, there are two types of variations. It is the continuous variations and the discontinuous variations. Darwin told all about the continuous variations. He told that every variation occurs in a gradual manner, very slow process it is. But Hugo de Vries told that it is not a very continuous one. It is a discontinuous one. It appears suddenly in the generations and it cannot be ignored. Darwin also saw discontinuous variations, but it was the number was so less, and he called them spots, not mutations. So he called them spots. And Hugo de Vries called them mutations, and they appeared suddenly, and means this cannot be ignored. Though continuous variations are very slow, they sometimes get ignored. We cannot see them. But these mutations or the sudden appearance of variations, they cannot be ignored because they are mainly due to the change in the genetic makeup. We'll understand when we go through the examples. Okay. Now, he mainly worked, that is Hugo de Vries, mainly worked on evening primrose. Okay. The scientific name of evening primrose is Oenothera lamarckiana. And this plant grew around his house wildly in his around his house, so it was easy for him to perform the experiments with this plant. So what he did, he collected some plants from his nearby his house, and he self-pollinated the plants. After self-pollination, what was seen, the seeds were naturally produced, and these seeds produced the first generation. That is a parental generation, he self-pollinated, and the first generation which was produced, he saw majority of the plants, majority of the plants were like the parent plant, normal. Very minor variations were there, very minor changes were there, which were unnoticed, which can be ignored. And few of them had some major variations, variations which could be noticed and cannot be ignored. Now, what he did in the next half, he took these plants with different or with major variations, these few plants where which were showing major variations, major changes, and he self-pollinated them. What he saw was that again, two types of plants were produced. Few were different plants like the parent plants. Okay, like the parent plants, they were there. Means majority of them were same as the parent plants with minor variations. And the other category which was produced was still more different with very major variations. The other one was minor variations. They were majority of them. And few were there who had major variations and were totally different from the parent plant. So what he came to a conclusion that this appearance of this sudden variations was mainly, it cannot be ignored, first of all, because it was very obvious. The variations were very obvious and it cannot be ignored. And he also saw, he found out that there was change in the genetic makeup, that is change in the chromosome number. How? The normal plants or the first selected plants, that is the parent plants, had chromosome number 14. Okay, we'll go to the next slide. I have written there all these things. The this chromosome number of the parent plant is 14. That is, we are talking about the diploid chromosome number. Okay, so diploid chromosome number was 14. But these varieties with major variations, which we saw in the second generation, had different chromosome number. That is, somewhere 16, some 20, some 24. So he understood that whenever these mutations take place or these sudden appearance of variations take place, then there is a change in the genetic makeup. And these genetic makeup, whenever there is a change in the genetic makeup, it is very obvious and very, it cannot be, means ignored. And in one of the plant, the variation was so huge, that is, the flower size was very big, the flower size, the flower color, the plant size was very big, and he gave a different name to this variety. He called it Oenothera gigas. He gave the name. And whatever variations he saw in the different plants, it was generally the flower size, the color of the flower, the size of the plant, etc., etc., okay? So, he was very confident that what Darwin told, that variations are continuous and a slow, gradual process, he told totally opposite of that. Because Darwin also saw these certain variations, but the examples or the means what experiments he performed, there the number of major variations were very minor or very less, few in number. So, he ignored them. But here in this Oenothera lamarckiana, the variations were so sudden and so obvious that he was not able to ignore them. And he also concluded that it was due to the change in the genetic makeup. He had some postulates of his mutation theory. He told that mutations are sudden, large and distinct, discontinuous heritable changes. All organisms have an inherent tendency to mutate. All have. Okay. Mutations always appear full-fledged. There are always full-fledged mutations. Mutations always can be seen in a full-fledged form. That is, there are no incipient stages, means no intermediate stages. Full-fledged means what? No in-between stages in the development of a character or an organ. It happens suddenly. Mutations always appear full-fledged. Mutations are indeterminate. That is, they appear in all directions and may be useful or harmful. Always it will be in good form. That is not the case. Sometimes it may not be harmful also. And those mutations which are harmful, they are naturally, those species are omitted. But the ones which are useful are subjected to, means they are subjected to natural selection, and the harmful ones are removed, and the useful ones are inherited in the offspring. And mutation is a very jerky process. So these are some of the conclusions which he gave, or postulates which he gave. Let us go into the next. In this slide, or now we'll be starting with the modern theory of evolution. This modern theory of evolution is also known as Neo-Darwinism. And some other names of this theory are, that is, modern synthetic theory, or also known as modern theory of evolution. Why modern theory of evolution? Because it is the most accepted one. That's why modern theory of evolution. And why synthetic theory? Because it is formed by a synthesis of two theories, that is, the Darwin's theory of natural selection and Hugo de Vries' theory of mutation. So that's why it is known as a synthesis or synthetic theory. So, what was all about this Neo-Darwinism? According to this concept, new species originate due to the interaction of genetic variations and natural selection. Two major forces which lead to the origin of new species are genetic variations or genetic variability and natural selection. And it is the result of the following five factors. Following five factors help in the formation of new species. That is, genetic variability, which is actually variations in the gene pool. What do you mean by gene pool? Gene pool is the total number of genes which are present in a population, okay, of a species. In a population of a species is known as a gene pool. It is isolation. Isolation means separation of species. Natural selection, genetic basis or adaptability, or that is adaptations which are seen, and speciation, that is origin of new species. So only out of these, only these five, only two are more important, and we'll discuss those things, that is genetic variability and natural selection, which are the two elemental forces of evolution which lead to the rise of new species. So let us see what is all about this genetic variability and natural selection.
Now, children, what we see here is genetic about, we learn about genetic variability, which is one of the causes of it's one of the main points of new Darwinism. Now, here in genetic variability, what is told all about genetic variability is that what does this mean? Actually, there are genetic differences or changes in the genetic makeup of individuals in a population. And how and why these genetic variability or variations in the genes or changes in the genes of the population occur. So the first point which we'll talk about as the main reason why this genetic variability occurs is mutation. Now, mutations, you have a rough idea, that is, the mutations are sudden changes in the genetic makeup of an individual. Now, mutations are of two types, gene mutations and chromosomal mutations. Now, when we are talking about these mutations, we have to understand what is gene mutation and what is chromosomal mutation. Gene mutations are also known as point mutations. There are of two types. The first one is frameshift mutation and the second one is substitution mutation. What do you mean by frameshift? You know, children, I have already told you in class 11 that whenever there is a code on the mRNA, and that these codes are read on the mRNA in the form of codons, in triplets. Codons are in triplets, and each triplet forms a protein. Now, what happens when there is change in one of the nitrogenous base? Then there will naturally be shift in the reading frame. Now, how it happens that frameshift mutations are shifts? This shifts the reading frame of the genetic message so that the protein may not be able to perform its function. Now, we know that any function in our body is performed by ultimately the proteins. Now, see in the diagram of insertion, can you see a T has been inserted between A and G? So this T is inserted. So this is an insertion, that is insertion process of frameshift. Under deletion process of frameshift, what we see? Between this G and G, this A which was present is deleted, and G has come together. Now, if we take this as a message which has to be read on the mRNA, so see the message here, the fat cat ate the rat. In threes it is there, in triplets. Now, what happened at insertion? A H has been added in front of the cat, C. So what has happened? See, the reading frame has changed. Always it is in triplets, it is read. So the fat HCA, then after that, the full frame after from where it has been inserted, it has changed, which doesn't provide any meaning, and hence the protein might not be able to perform its function. Okay, what function it has to perform. Similarly, when we come to deletion, see the deletion part. What happened here? From the fat, the H has been removed. Now, when this H has been removed from where the point where the H has been removed, from that point, the whole frame has shifted. See, T, E, F, A, T, C, the whole meaning has changed. And so, the protein will not be formed, and the particular protein which was required will not be formed, and hence will not be able to perform its function. So, for the point from which there has been change in the means reading frame. That's why the name frame shift mutation under point mutation. Okay. Now we come to the substitution mutation. Here we can see what in substitution what happens. Here there is substitution. Substitution means what? Somebody will replace someone else. Now what happens in substitution is that in the starting sequence, you can see the starting sequence which is given there. G and C is given, which is marked in green in the substitution part. Now, what happens in substitution? Substitution mutations are of two types, transition and transversion. Transition, what happens? A purine will be replaced by purine and a pyrimidine will be replaced by pyrimidine. Now, I think hope all of you remember, children, in class 10 what you read. What are the four nitrogenous bases? Adenine, guanine, cytosine and thymine. Now, out of these four nitrogenous bases, two are purines and two are pyrimidines. Which are the purines? The purines are adenine and guanine, and cytosine and thymine are the pyrimidines. Now, what happens in transition? A purine will be replaced by a purine and a pyrimidine by a pyrimidine. So what happens? See in the portion which is marked green. So here in the original sequence, G is a what? It is a purine and it is replaced by another purine, that is A. And C is a pyrimidine. It is replaced by another purine, which is T. Similarly, what we see is in transversion, what happens? Purine is replaced or substituted by a pyrimidine, and pyrimidine is substituted by a purine. So what happens? C is what? C is actually a pyrimidine. So pyrimidine C is replaced by starting sequence. G is a purine, and purine is changed to C. C is a pyrimidine. Similarly, C in the original sequence, C, what is C? It is a pyrimidine, and it has been changed into a purine. So similar changes which happen comes under transversion. So these are actually changes in the genetic makeup, and these are happening at a point. That's why sometimes they are known as point mutations also. For chromosomal mutations, children, we'll go into the next slide. In the next slide, the description about chromosomal mutations will go in detail. Now here in the chromosomal mutations can be either change in the number of genes or changes in the number of chromosomes. So let us first take changes in the number of genes. What is seen here? See in the first one, deletion, duplication, inversion and reciprocal translocation, or just translocation also you can tell. So what we can see here in this changes in the number of genes, first deletion. Deletion sometimes is also known as deficiency, okay? Now, naturally, from the word only, we can understand that deletion means one of the genes will be removed. You can see the genes which are present there, A, B, C, D, E, on one side of the centromere, on the other side of the centromere has F, G, H. So, what we see after deletion, this D has been deleted. So, that is deletion. That is loss of one or more genes due to deletion of chromosome segment. A part of it has been deleted. And do not forget the difference between gene and chromosomes. Okay, genes are a part of DNA. And chromosome is when cell has to undergo division, the chromatin threads, when the cell was not divided, is in the form of chromatin threads, and it becomes condensed to form chromosomes. Ultimately, the chromosome chromatin threads only condense to form these chromosomes. Okay, now what here in the next one happens, it is duplication. In duplication, what happens, there is addition of one or more genes due to doubling of the chromosome segment. Here it doubles. Now see, for example, here what happens, B and C, A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H. Now B and C is doubled. See in the next one after duplication, A, B, C, B, C, D, E, F, G, H is the same. Now come to inversion. What happens in inversion? It is again a rearrangement of the genes. Arrangement of the genes occurs here. In the first one, we had only the changes in the number of genes, and here we are having arrangement, rearrangement. In inversion, what is happening? Rotating of a block of genes in a chromosome, which happens by 180 degree. So that the sequence of the genes is inverted or it is reversed. See, here A, B, C, D, B, C, D. This B, C, D is fully 180 degree, it has rotated. So it has come to what? A, D, C, B, E, F, G, H. Clear? Now we come to the last one, that is translocation. Translocation means it will move from one, always in translocation there will be two chromosomes which will be taken into consideration. See, the first one has A, B, C, D, E, F, G, H, and the next one has M, N, O, P, Q and R. So what happens? See, after translocation, see the segment AB from the first chromosome has moved into the second chromosome, attached to the second chromosome. And in case of the second chromosome, M and O has gone into the first chromosome. So this is how translocation takes place. Now translocation, do not think that always as I have put here, the translocation will be in a similar manner. Sometimes what happened, the AB can move and join with the R portion, that side, not with the side of P, not in the front portion, and the back portion also it can go and join. Okay, so it depends. That's why reciprocal translocation is the name given to this one. Now, changes in the number of chromosomes. What we see in the changes of the number of chromosomes is, in the first one, first and foremost, I want to tell you children that you know about haploid and diploid, chromosome number. You know about that. Haploid is half the chromosome and diploid means we have double the chromosomes. Now, are aware of this haploid and haploid. What examples can you give? The gametes. Gametes are haploid. They have only one set. Full one set of chromosomes. For example, we have how many pairs of chromosomes? We have 23. Isn't it? So they will have, we have 23 pairs. When diploid we are, that is 46 we have. We are diploid organisms. In our somatic cells, we have 46 chromosomes, that is 23 pairs. But when our gametes are formed, it is sperm and ova of humans, what happens? It is halved. That is, we have haploid number. That is, only one set is there. It is chromosome number 1 to 23, only one are there of each. Okay? We know that all our chromosomes from 1 to 23, all are homologous chromosomes except the last one, that is the 23rd pair. They are different in case of males. Otherwise, all are homologous chromosomes, and there are two, means it has one pair. For example, chromosome number 1 has two, means one pair. Chromosome number 2 has again one pair. So, pairing is there. Homologous chromosomes, we'll call them. Similarly, what happens in case of changing in the chromosome number, you can see here that there is a change in the entire set. What is there? Is in the first one, you can say actually it is a bit hazy. The first one is haploid. See, only one set. See, this one set, this is one set, this is one set. This is seen in what? This is seen in the gametes. Now, second one is the diploid one. Can you see a pink one? Two. So, one set has two homologous chromosomes. The second one, that is the blue or purple, whatever you say, it has again two, and the yellow one also has two. So diploid. Now what happens sometimes? Triploid is there. Triploid. What does triploidy or triploid means? That this pink one, which is two here, sometimes are three. So triploidy. So threes are there. Similarly, the this one. The blue one is also, or the purple one is also 3, and the last one, that is the yellow, is also one, is also 3. Now, in the tetraploid, or we call it tetraploidy also. So, here what we can see, that is the means each set of the chromosome is represented more than twice. So, each set is not present twice, it is double, means double or triple, or sometimes more than means four also. This is called polyploidy also sometimes. So here you can see the entire set is four times. Here also it is four times. Here also it is four times. So it is called this means when it is more than three, it is generally called polyploidy. Okay, so that means haploidy is n. Diploidy or diploid is 2n. That is, each set will be having two times. When triploidy or triploid, that means each set will be three times. That is, chromosome number 1 will be three times, the homologous pair. Chromosome number 2 will be three times. Chromosome number 3 will be three times, like this. Okay. When we come to tetraploidy, means it will be four times repeated. When pentaploidy, it will be five times repeated. This is all about the means changes in the number of chromosomes, which we are talking about the entire set. Okay, the entire set is repeated how many times, that is all about this one. Then this change in the number of chromosomes is again means which we will take only one set, the change in only one set, the whole set is not there. That is, from 1 to 23, for example, in this diagram you can see that is there are four sets of chromosomes which are shown, isn't it? The diploid number, see, 1 2 3 4, in the next diagram of the number of chromosomes, changes in the number of chromosomes, here you can see four sets. Now in this four sets, what we happens in this is actually the first one which we dealt with, that is when the whole entire set is repeated or changed, it is that is known as heteroploidy. Okay, and the second one which we see, that is change in the number of only one set, is known as aneuploidy. Now what happens here? Here, for example, you can see the first one in aneuploidy. Here you can see that the first four are shown, that is diploid chromosome number. What happens? The fourth set or the fourth one, both are gone. Means what happens here? Plus minus one or two happens. Our diploid set is 2n, that is 2n minus 1 it can be, 2n minus 2 it can be. It can be also plus, that is 2n plus 1 or 2n plus 2. So what happens here? In case of this 2n minus 2, what happens? 2 are gone from one set, only one set. That is the fourth set. See, from the fourth set, both are gone. So it is nullisomic. It is called nullisomic. Whenever only one is gone from the diploid set, only one is gone from one of the sets. So see, we can see the number of chromosome number 4, only one of the homologous chromosomes is there. So it is what? Monosomic. Now see, here what happens? Doubly monosomic means here in two sets, that is third one as well as in the fourth one, one set homologous pair is gone. So that's why 2n minus 1 minus 1. Why they have written minus 1 separately? Because from the third set one has gone, from the fourth set one more has gone. That's why. Trisomic is 2n plus 1. That is, in the fourth set, see, there is another addition. That is, 2 odd should be there. It has been, here it has 3. Similarly, tetrasomic. Tetrasomic means 2 will be added. So, see, in the fourth chromosome, what we see, 4 homologous pair are there. Not 2. 2 are not there. There are 4. So, similarly, what happens when doubly tetrasomic means 2 will be added in 2 sets. Means single sets, 2 are added. So, here 2 sets are added. Here also in the doubly tetrasomic, 2 are added. So, this is all about aneuploidy. So, all these changes in the mutation part that we saw, that is the gene mutations, which is also known as the point mutation, which had this frame shift and the substitution mutations. We saw there also changes in the genetic makeup is there, or either another change in the mutation, by mutation, another change can be in the chromosomes. In the number of chromosomes, it is different. Here we can see that there can be deletion, duplication, inversion, and translocation, which is in the number of genes. And when in the number of chromosome as a whole, then it is either heteroploidy or aneuploidy. So this is all about mutations which occurs. Now the next cause of genetic variability is genetic recombination, gene recombination. Now what is all about this gene recombination? Now what happens in sexually reproducing organisms? Okay, new combinations. Okay, children, one more thing I forgot to tell you, that you saw these chromosomes are getting minus or plus as a whole. Now, why does this happen? This is due to the non-disjunction. What happens? You know that in meiosis, when the gametes are formed in the anaphase 1, the two homologous pair has to separate to two poles. Now, what happens in non-disjunction? Non-disjunction, what happens? They are not separated, during anaphase 1, these homologous pair do not separate and do not go to two different poles. Both the chromosomes remain in one side only. So what happens when an egg is formed? What happens when the egg is formed? Two eggs if formed, or four eggs might be formed. One will have all the chromosomes in it and the other will not have it. So that's why this is called a rough idea of disjunction, non-disjunction, which doesn't happen and which leads to these kind of problems. Or that in the genetic makeup, that is change in the chromosome number. Now, genetic recombination we were talking about. Now, what happens in genetic recombination? That is, in sexually reproducing organism, what happens? New combinations of different genes we always see, isn't it? And how these different combinations are occur. First and foremost, crossing over, we all know. What happens in crossing over? There is exchange of segments between the non-sister chromatids of the maternal and the paternal chromosomes. This we are aware about. You read in class 10 also. Now, in case of dual parentage, because of dual parentage, you know that in sexually reproducing organism, there are two parents which are involved, due to which there's a male parent and the female parent, which contribute their gametes, that is the male gamete and the female gamete, due to which dual parentage, there is different kinds of genes which are seen, and therefore recombination of genes takes place. Independent assortment of homologous chromosomes is another reason of each pair at a time of formation of haploid gametes. That is independent assortment. What you read about independent assortment? That is, they means it does not depend, means one of the genes does not depend on the other genes that whom it will go and attach to. It is fully independent of each other. They separate without concerning each other genes. This is all about independent assortment. These are the reasons why genetic recombination takes place in case of sexual reproduction, and ultimately leads to variation, that is genetic variability. Gene flow or gene migration is the next one. Gene flow and gene migration, what does this mean? This is actually that we know that the movement of individuals from one place to another is called what? Migration. And if the migrating individuals, the individuals who are migrating, breed within the new population, okay? What I am telling, that these migrating individuals, if they breed within the new population, the immigrants will add new alleles. The ones who have come from outside, they will add some new genes or new alleles into the local genes which are already present. So what will happen into the gene pool? New alleles are added. Because of whom? Because of the immigrants who have come from outside. Into the host population, these new alleles are added, and this is called gene migration. Now, sometimes these two populations of the species, which are separated, come close due to migration, and the genes of the two populations, they intermingle through breeding, and thus result causing variations in the offspring. Now, the last one is genetic drift. Another one we have, that is hybridization. Genetic drift is actually what? Drastic or sudden change in the allele frequency in a small population. Very, very important point of genetic drift, that genetic drift sometimes is also known as allele drift, is because there is a sudden change or drastic change in the change in the allele frequency. Allele means, I hope you know that alternative forms of genes are known as alleles. For example, if small t and capital T are the genes which are present in an organism for tallness, then capital T is one allele and the small t is another allele. I hope you have that in your mind, what you read in class 10. And in the same in a small population, very important, genetic drift always occurs in small population. In larger population, genetic drift doesn't have any influence. Now, what is all about this genetic drift? Genetic drift means by chance, like it might be epidemic or floods or earthquakes, some of the alleles are totally eradicated. That is a sudden change, and that some of the alleles of the small population are eradicated by chance. Nobody has deliberately done that, but due to chance, it has happened. So what is about genetic drift? A genetic drift is a drastic change in the allele frequency when the population size becomes very small. Therefore, it alters the gene frequency of the remaining population, which causes variation. So if, for example, I am giving you an example, it will be easier for you to understand. For example, in the original population, there genes like BB, that is, I am talking about capital B, small b, and one capital, one small b. So three types of genes we are seeing here. That is capital B, small b, and capital B. Now, due to some natural calamity or due to epidemics or something in a small population, be very clear, what happens? One of the genes got eradicated. That is, one of the genes got eradicated. That thing, that is small b, got eradicated. So, what is left? That is B, that is capital B, and small b is only left. So it will affect, this type of calamities or sudden changes affect the variations, because because one of the genes has already gone. So these will intermingle and a new type of population might be formed by variations. Okay, this was found out by a scientist, American geneticist. His name was Sewall Wright, and he realized its influence on evolution, and that's why this is also sometimes called as Sewall Wright effect. Now let us go into the next slide. Now here you can see the last one, that is hybridization. What happens? Crossing of organisms which are genetically different in one or more traits. Okay, crossing of organisms, but they are of the same species. Okay, they are genetically, crossing of organisms takes place, which are genetically different in one. Genetically different means, for example, what genes I am also human being and you are also human being, but we will not be having the same genes, isn't it? So we are genetically different, but they will be of the same species. Crossing of organisms which are genetically different in one or more traits, that is in one or more characters. Okay, for example, I am having a trait for tallness, that is TNT, that is capital T and small t, and one of my students might be having a trait of any other trait like capital D, capital E, or small t. So this we are talking about genetically different. We are genetically different. So traits means characters. This, now what it helps into? It helps in intermingling of genes of different groups of the same species. Now intermingling of genes takes place of the same species. Now the next one under this, we talked about that this new Darwinism told that first one which leads to evolution is genetic variability. We had a conversation about genetic variability. The next one is natural selection. Now what does this natural selection means? This natural selection, actually we have a rough idea of this natural selection. What does this natural selection mean is that natural selection is what? It operates only in large population first and foremost, and nature selects. Okay, which organisms are better adapted will be selected by nature. So nature selects the better adapted organisms. Now what happens? that these better adapted organisms reproduce at a faster rate. Okay, they will always reproduce at a fast rate. Why they will reproduce at a faster rate? Because they are better adapted to the surroundings and the environment, and hence will produce more number of offspring, and thus will produce more number of offsprings. And here, in case of according to neo Darwinism, what natural selection meant was, natural selection operates only on large population, not on small population. It is differential and non-random reproduction of successful genotypes producing comparative reproductive success. Now, differential reproduction, I have already told you that all organisms which we see around, all are do not have the same rate of reproduction. Elephants have very slower rate of reproduction, while bacteria have very fast reproduction rate. So this reproduction rate generally is based on natural selection, because nature favors them to reproduce faster. So here you can see a parental generation which I have put there, where the variants are 1 by 10, only one variant is there, all are same. In the second this one, but this black dot which you can see is a very good adapted one, it is a better adapted organism. So in this next generation, you can see the variants have increased by 3:12, that is 25%. Now in the third or the second offspring generation, what you see, 9:18, that is 50% are the black ones. And in the last one, you can see the number of variants have increased up to 27, that is 75% are the new adapted ones, or the better adapted ones, and the ones who were previously present, there is a parental generation, have decreased a lot. That is 25% only left of the parental generation. So what happens, you can see that when an allele, for example, if I give an example, when an allele, that is A, makes an organism more efficient in reproduction than its other allele means small a. The capital L is A is more efficient in reproduction than its allele small a. Naturally, the frequency of allele A, that is capital A, will gradually increase in the gene pool because it is better adapted, and generation after generation, and allele A will gradually, that is small a, will gradually decrease. Thus, natural selection is creative force and is achieved either by increased rate of reproduction or by decreased vulnerability to the environmental agents responsible for their mortality. Okay, so children, this is all about today's lesson. What all we had discussed about the gene mutations, those gene mutations and all this will discuss again the principles of heredity, that is Mendel's chapter, again genetics. Under genetics, we'll discuss all these things again. But to be very specific, read all these things carefully, understand the concepts. If you don't understand the concept, it will be harder for you to write. So please understand this, and next class we'll start with natural selection, some examples and types of natural selection, we'll start with that. So continue with this part and read it nicely, listen to the video lesson nicely, and take the help of the book. Okay children, thank you, I'll meet you soon.